Guitarists Toolkit.
With Guitar Guitar.
Hey, I'm Chris Buck here at Guitar Guitar, and this is my artist toolkit. Now, something I get a fair amount of questions about, I guess, is my approach, not just to soloing, but something relatively unusual I do, I guess, which is more often than not focusing on one or two strings at a time, not necessarily working my way up and down the fretboards in the kind of boxes, I guess, that guitar players can be a little bit guilty of doing on occasion, but thinking more in a kind of linear sense, I guess, working my way from one end of the fretboards to the tether, maybe on one or two strings. To give you an idea of what I'm talking about, let's just play a basic major scale, the key of C on one string. Conversely, minor. Now, knowing that doesn't seem all that inherently useful in itself, I guess, but as I said, my approach to soloing kind of is based heavily around that and being very familiar with the intervals and the distance between notes, where they lie relative to one another, just on maybe one or two strings. So a lot of the faster kind of runs I do, a lot of the kind of that kind of stuff, as I said, is very reliant on just being comfortable with the intervals, distance between notes, where they lie relative to one another, or maybe just one or two strings. Now, again, in itself, doesn't seem all that inherently useful, I guess, but my approach to soloing has always been underpinned by the fact that I'm a huge kind of fan of vocalists, I guess, huge fan of great vocalists. Grew up on a kind of very heavy soul diet, whether it's Otis Redding to Aretha Franklin, to stuff that my grandfather was playing me, whether that was Frank Sinatra or Ella Fitzgerald or Nat King Cole. Anyone with great phrasing was kind of what I was hooked on as a kid. I remember my grandfather sitting me down and saying, listen to Frank Sinatra's phrasing. I guess I was probably 6, 7, 8 at the time, really, and didn't kind of have the first idea what he was talking about. I was like, what's phrasing? He was like, the way he sings the words. I was like, well, surely just the way you sing the words are just the words for the song. You're not really given that many options, surely. He's like, no, listen to the breathing, listen to the space between the notes, how he kind of slides into certain notes, how he falls off other notes. And that kind of opened my ear and opened my kind of brain, I guess, to this world of phrasing and world of articulation, fluidity and clarity and all of the kind of stuff that you associate with great vocalists. And as much as I'm a huge guitar fan, you know, again, grew up on a diet of Clapton, of Stevie Ray, of Slash, of, you know, Angus Young, all of the kind of usual guitar aspects, I guess. As I said, my soloing, I've always tried to underpin it with this idea of that vocal fluidity. And if you're a singer, you don't think in terms of boxes, you don't think in terms of shapes or scales or modes or, you know, these kind of constructs that we kind of limit ourselves to as guitar players every now and then. So, as I said, kind of working my way up and down the neck, maybe on one or two strings, just seemed to make infinitely more sense to me. Gives you a slightly broader palette in terms of, as I said, how you approach notes or maybe how you fall off notes. So, let's take a very simple lick. Start the major scale, kind of very simple, I guess, at heart. Open that up into something like. Just by bending those notes, as opposed to physically kind of moving between the frets, to me at least, kind of cops some of that feel of, as I said, great singers, whether it's Otis Redding, whether it's Sam Cooke, or Paolo Nutini, or insert great vocalists here, there will be that phrasing, there'll be that fluidity and effortlessness in their phrasing. So, as I said, if you familiarize yourself with the intervals and just where the notes lie relative to one another, that for me at least feels a little bit more free and a little bit, I don't know, better, I guess, for want of a better phrase, than just kind of working your way up and down those traditional kind of shape major scales. So, again, on one string in the key of, let's take C minor this time. literally one string, you would quite happily get away with just doing an entire solo like that. As I said, a lot of the faster runs, it's not going to be entirely practical to do that entirely on one string, at which point maybe open it up to a second string, whether that's, in this case, whether that's your thin E string or whether that's your G string. So a lot of the kind of so again, that was kind of leaning more heavily on, I guess, the top three strings or the bottom three strings, depending on your orientation, which side of the world you're living on. But again, for me, that just opens up a broader palette of sounds and a more effortless feel to your soloing, I guess, or your lead playing or just your phrasing in general, rather than trying to work your way from top to bottom using all six strings, I guess. And that's not denigrate being familiar with a guitar in its entirety, but I think once you're at a point where you're relatively comfortable with the kind of the layout of the fretboard, where your notes are, again, underpinning all this is a familiarity with where notes are and being able to pinpoint certain notes pretty quickly. And inherent in that then, being able to outline chord tones, et cetera, all of the usual kind of good stuff. But for me, at least, once you're at a point where you're comfortable with where notes lie, really does open up a kind of a broader spectrum of sounds just to be able to try and work your way up and down on one or two strings. It's a relatively unusual approach, I guess. This, you know, it's not widely advised, and I'm not saying just learn to use one string, you know, that's not the kind of point of this, but for me at least, you know, kind of makes sense a little bit. There was a solo I did on a video on YouTube a while ago with Mr. Paul Davids, challenged 10 guitar players to do a solo on the same track, and the solo for that, again, was quite heavily reliant on just being kind of centric on one or two strings. So it was an opening. At least something like that. But you'll notice there are a few of those runs, especially that ergonomically might have made more sense to do that across multiple strings and whatever that would have been. But for me at least, this kind of a certain quality to playing all of those notes on one string, especially with those little kind of vocal inflections to end that lick, which just sound particularly unique. And again, give it that kind of vocal fluidity and freedom. There's not many ways more I can say that, I guess, without repeating myself. So I'll probably leave it there. But as I said, at the point of this video, at least familiarize yourself with the intervals, the distance between the notes, where they lie relative to one another, or maybe just one or two strings, maybe one string to start off with. Take a scale that you're uber familiar with, if it's your minor pentatonic shape, or if it's just a straight major scale. Familiarize yourself with it on one string and then try to incorporate that into your playing. Just broader palette, different sounds, saves you practicing. Thanks for watching.